Hi, I'm Gino Graziano with University of Alaska Fairbanks Cooperative Extension Service Integrated Pest Management Program. And today we're going to be talking about chokecherry in Alaska as an invasive species. Chokecherry are a broad group of cherry tree species in the Prunus genus that are known for these small fruits that are quite bitter. Two species of chokecherry were introduced into Alaska that have spread out of cultivation. Those two species are Prunus padus, known as the European bird cherry or mayday tree, and Prunus virginiana, which is the Canada red chokecherry tree. These tree species spread from cultivation because of their fruits when the birds eat them and then deposit them later on their flight paths. They can also spread by their roots that come through the ground, and if they're cut down, those trees can turn into a shrub quite easily from their roots and their stumps. We introduced the species of chokecherry into Alaska because they're a hardy tree species with these attractive fruits to birds, as well as flowers that are quite showy in the early spring. In addition to those features, it is not typically damaged by moose, which is quite a win if you're a landscaper or just someone who wants a showy tree that they don't have to have a fence around in their front yard. However, we've noticed this tree spreading throughout the state of Alaska in many parts, from Fairbanks all the way down to places on the Kenai Peninsula and some in southeast Alaska. It's probably most successful though in south central and parts of the interior, particularly along streams and river corridors where it seems to have a lot of water and the birds are depositing its seeds. Identification of chokecherry trees can be quite easy in the springtime when they're flowering or in the fall when they have clusters of fruit. The fruits will have a large stone on the inside, which is different than any other the native tree species in Alaska. There are some shrubs in Alaska that have fruits that look similar to a cherry. However, they do not have the big stones, other than a cranberry, which has a flat stone as opposed to a round stone. If there's no fruits present, you can always use the leaves to identify them as well. They have a serrated edge on the leaf edge, and also the leaves have these glands at the base, which are definitive of species in the Prunus genus. And only species in the Prunus genus have those glands. So if you see those glands, it is definitely not a native tree species to the state. As chokecherry spreads in Alaska, it often forms very thick infestations, such as this one here, where virtually all these trees behind me and in front of me are chokecherry trees. When this happens, they often shade out the other understory vegetation that we would normally see growing in the boreal forest, such as cranberries, currants, dwarf dogwood, roses, and ferns, and other species. As the chokecherry spreads along our streams and rivers in Alaska, it can affect the stream food web. A University of Alaska Fairbanks graduate student, David Roon, studied the contribution of insects from these trees and the native tree species in Alaska towards the stream. And those insects that fall off of the leaves into the stream can actually contribute a significant portion of a rearing salmon's diet. And what they found was that these chokecherry trees contribute far fewer insects to the streams than our native species do. We're going to talk about control of chokecherry trees. Today we're here at the University of Alaska Fairbanks Experiment Station, where we've set up some control trials on some of these trees using various types of herbicides on basal bark treatments, but we're going to take a step back and talk about some of the other methods first. If you have smaller trees, you can actually pull those right out of the ground. You just have to make sure and get all of the roots out. Larger trees are a little bit more difficult because you can't get the roots out completely just by pulling and yanking them up. You can't cut the trees down because if you cut them down, they simply come back from the stump itself, resprouting, or they'll resprout from the roots. So you have to get all of those roots out or kill the roots in the process, which is why we are testing herbicides out, because herbicides can systemically travel through the plant and kill that root system off. Now, biological controls of these chokecherry trees aren't tested or known in Alaska yet. Traditional insects or diseases, we don't have any that we know of that would work or that are approved for use on these trees. And grazing, which is another type of biological control, isn't really recommended because the cyanide toxicity within these trees could cause problems for those animals. All right, there's four basic kinds of chemical treatments that you can use for these chokecherry trees. First is foliar treatments, where you would actually spray the chemical onto the foliage of the trees, and that will then translocate through the foliage into the tree itself. Another type of treatment is more direct. It's called a frill treatment, where you cut into the trunk of the tree and then squirt a small amount of herbicide, concentrated herbicide, into that cut. You can also use a cut stump treatment, and this involves cutting the tree down. When you cut the tree down, you want to very quickly after the tree is cut down, apply a small amount of herbicide, concentrated herbicide again, onto that stump area. And the fourth type of treatment, which is what we're actually trialing out here at the experiment station today, are basal bark treatments. And basal bark treatments have an amount of herbicide mixed in with an oil carrier that you spray onto the trunk of the tree. And then that herbicide is then absorbed through the trunk of the tree, where it can then kill the tree and the root system as well. I'm going to show you one of the direct treatments we do, basal bark treatments. Again, basal bark treatments are herbicide placed in basal oil or another oil carrier that is absorbed through the bark of the tree and then kills the tree. So I've got a little sprayer here. We're going to spray the lower 12 to 16 inches of the bark of the tree all the way down to the ground. Just enough to cover it. And that's that. We prefer to often use these more direct treatments because they get less herbicide out into the environment and concentrate that herbicide onto the species that we're trying to remove. We introduced the chokecherry tree to Alaska with great intentions. As you can see though, its impacts to native vegetation and stream ecology are a potential problem to the state of Alaska. We encourage you to learn as much as you can about the chokecherry tree, report infestations to new areas, and help in the removal of this tree from Alaska.